So Buddha Cafe, I started, or I found actually a year and a half ago, and I was going to live there first, but then people showed up because it says Buddha Cafe on the window, and people stepped into my living room every day and say, hey, can I get coffee? So then I like, I guess I have to open back up Buddha Cafe, which I did. On Friday nights, I run Crypto Night.
Mm-hmm.
And Crypto Night is basically becoming an entertainment program where I also educate people on what's going on in the crypto space, mm-hmm. but also can do like a stand-up comedy act or open mic, some music around it where people can drink in a cocktail.
Welcome to this new episode, and today I am here with Edwin. How are you, Edwin?
Very good, thank you very much.
Very nice. So Edwin is the owner of Buddha Cafe in Copangan and also an expert of cryptocurrencies. He's the founder and owner of CryptoCation, which is a crypto company. So Edwin, can you tell us a little bit more about your background first?
Sure. I have an IT background, been in corporate IT for pharmaceutical companies most of my life. Lived, was born in the Netherlands, moved to the United States, came back to Europe, Belgium, Germany, and then 2.5 years ago, I made my my way here to the island in Copenhagen. And then I was involved in a awakening and healing school here on the island.
Sure.
And then after a year and a half, for personal reasons, we decided that we would split up. And then I took basically 6 months of my life that I've never done before to take a time out to go, you know, enjoy the island life and the beaches and get back into shape and go back to the gym. And then I rolled into crypto and then I got lost in crypto.
Very nice. So today we're going to talk about cryptocurrencies, obviously, because Edwin has been, you know, somebody, literally a magnet for people in the crypto space here, because you've been running events, crypto-related events, and possibly you want to do more as well, making Buddha Cafe a bit of a center for that, which is lovely. And also, indeed, it seems you have a keen passion for awakening or the holistic therapies, is that right? So let's start with that first. So how did you get passionate about healing?
Well, the funny thing is that 2.5 years ago, I was, you know, ready to step out of the system, what I call it, you know, ready to step out of the day-to-day routine life, to go to an office, have an office job, make money, pay the bills, and, you know, and I was getting tired of that. And 5 years prior to that, I looked into that as well, but it wasn't the right time. And then 2.5 years ago, 3.5 years ago by now, I looked online saying, hey, can I buy, you know, something that I would be the owner of, and can I do this myself? And then I looked online on the website called businessesforsale.com, and I typed in the amount I wanted to invest in Thailand, and the first opportunity that came was an awakening and healing school. And to make a long story short, is that that's how I rolled into it.
Cool.
And then I came and visited the school, and it's, you know, it struck some nerves is that I really truly felt after the first few weeks of being here and taking all these classes that I was in some sort of a coma, and some sort of a coma in the system, saying you just do the daily stuff because you were programmed to do because of education, your upbringing, you must work, you must do this, you must pay taxes and stuff. And that basically evolved in me coming over here and making the investment, and boom. And then I was involved for like a year and a half in the spiritual side of life, and it really helped me to realize that I made that decision on the right time of my life to just come here and do something completely different.
That's lovely. You know, I really like it when people have the courage to decide to make such a big step in life and move away from their country, go to a new place like Thailand, and start a new life from scratch, you know. I think it's very inspirational. I think many people at home have this kind of desire sometimes, but very few actually do it, you know, and that's amazing.
Yes, well, I've been used to it since I got out of university. I basically did an internship at a company, and then I moved to the United States. So I've been moving every 5 years in my life. So for me, it's not necessarily a risk. I just do it. I don't even think about it. But for sure, out of all the friends that I've known, like, you know, very few that actually made the step and moved overseas. But it comes with a toll. You know, you move away from family and friends, and That's not always easy, but it does bring you, how do you say, a lot more freedom. And I always enjoyed that. So it's in that sense, taking more risk. But like I said, I have no regrets coming here 2.5 years ago. And I really think it's the best thing I've done in the many, many years.
And Koh Phangan is such a beautiful place, you know, the nature and the community is very interesting as well, very international. So I think indeed that, you know, you coming here was a great decision. Okay, let's talk about cryptocurrencies now. What you've been doing on the island and why are you so passionate about crypto?
So when I took my few months off, I started studying online because I wanted to do something different. And I found crypto and I started studying crypto. And then within a matter of a week, it just hit it struck like my brain, like being in IT. And this is coming from the IT world and programmers, and it's digital money and it's digitally programmed, that it made a lot of sense to me. And then I started to check out all these tools and go down the rabbit hole of crypto. And then I was fortunate enough to find an opportunity right here on the island with the project from Pate, from Carl Shasi, and he's, you know, on YouTube a lot.
Yeah,
he's been in the crypto space a long time, and I was able to become a private investor in that. And although I didn't invest so much money, that has been very, you know, very profitable and an amazing experience. But in the meantime, I started looking at, you know, what crypto was. I started studying Bitcoin and the technology and where it actually came from, and you know, it is just endless. Yeah, but I love the fact that, you know, we are just entering this space now that the technology of the internet is there, that this is a new wave that obviously is going to go 5 times faster than the internet development itself. And it is mind-boggling interesting what these people have come up with in the last 50 years, I would say, because Bitcoin didn't start in 2009. There's a whole story before that, where you can see that people already anticipated it, but the infrastructure wasn't there, the technology wasn't there. And then people, story upon story, have developed that into, you know, some programmers realizing the potential of it and being sick and tired of the, you know, the financial system the way that it currently still is. And they have created something new. They programmed a new digital asset.
And Koh Phangan has been, the past few months or years, increasingly a bit of a hub for cryptos. Yeah, mm-hmm. There are some startup companies, as you mentioned. You have some YouTube influencers. You have lots of people that are investing in the various currencies, and that's very interesting, isn't it? Because you know, Koh Phangan indeed stands out in Thailand, I think, for being a bit of a center for crypto.
It's mind-boggling interesting to me. It's amazing to see. I think that the entire island is into crypto now. Because, you know, I'm doing another blockchain project by myself, and you find all the people that you need right here on the island. And they go like, how in the world is that possible? So, you know, I think there's a lot of internet nomads and people in the digital world that work online. And it is absolutely amazing. And then, you know, I reached out to Bitasa, one of the exchanges here in Thailand, and I worked together with them a little bit. Mm-hmm. And they were very excited. And they also heard of Koh Phangan being, you know, crypto island. And I think it is amazing because everybody's talking about crypto now, which is good. You know, it's really, truly amazing. And I think that we could utilize that as an image for the island, because it is, you know, a new industry and a new world that I really think fits really well on this beautiful place. And it's basically green new economy. And yeah, it's every day it's amazing to me, because I still meet new people every day, you know, the co-founder of Dash, like, you know, and people from Chainlink, and now I'm partnering with Chainlink as an advocate and it just continues and it rolls very easily. It's beautiful. It's beautiful.
It's very exciting indeed. And of course, these people have quite a bit of cash as well. And that's why possibly the cost of land in Koh Phangan is going up so nicely. Good for the local Thai population as well,
yes.
I suppose. Yeah, Koh Phangan is a really special island in that sense. Always been the center of an alternative community and also alternative currencies, all coins as well.
Yes.
So that's very good, right? So can you tell us, I mean, Bitcoin, of course, is the currency that everybody knows is the most famous one. And then you have Ethereum, you have the large ones. But are you an investor in smaller coins as well? Or do you do any sort of new coin investment at all?
So I over the weekend I just cleaned up my entire bag, is what they say, bag of coins, because I had over like 150.
Wow.
Yeah, so that I started collecting because of IDOs, because of the paid program that I was doing. But then I realized it's you cannot sustain that. It's unmanageable. So if you look at crypto and you want to go about it the safe way, then Bitcoin is the safest way that you could do it. Yeah, mm-hmm. Bitcoin gets a lot of attention because now the big investors are coming to go into it. Banks, you know, governments, they are supporting it, even the US government. And so that's the safest way to go. So if you start following the logic of where most money is, you know, if you go to a site like CoinGecko, you can see that Bitcoin has now over 46% dominance. So most of the money is in Bitcoin. Then it goes to Ethereum, Binance, etc. So the more risk you want to take, the lower you go on the list of close to 10,000 ways to lose your money. That's what I say to people. Yeah, but so it becomes more gambling because you don't know. But if you follow the money and you want to invest safely, so Bitcoin is definitely the way to go for the future. And then you can get interest between 8% and 12% on Bitcoin. So it basically replacing all the old saving programs that you used to have with the bank. And what I've done now is I've shifted my portfolio to mostly Bitcoin and Ethereum and Binance, and then it goes down the list. So this is also, if you start following some people online, you know, influencers, a good strategy of managing your new digital portfolio. You start looking at what am I basically investing in? Because most people that come to, you know, the free talks that I do, they don't know where to start. Yeah. And I'm trying to explain them to now saying you need to see that Bitcoin is the mother of all coins. You know, it will never go away. It's the safest investment you could make, no matter the volatility that it has.
Yeah.
And if you start looking to the next part, you need to start looking at the new platforms in crypto, which you basically can compare to Windows, Apples, Androids of mm-hmm. this world. And so then you get into Ethereum, Cardano, Polkadot, Avalanche, Solano, and you can look at those as the new highways for cryptocurrencies. And all the other projects are basically stores around the highway, you know? I found somebody online that explained it as, oh, think about it as highways and shops. And all these highways, they basically need a gas station, or they need financial services, or they need a new digital wallet to hold coins, or they need, you know, gaming, NFTs, whatever it supports. So if you, according to what I'm doing now, is that you start looking at, try to invest in these highways, because, you know, all these projects are depending on these highways. So then the risks is, you know, is lower than picking a random project that might or might not work. Invest in a currency and you make some profits. That's the whole idea. And then you take the profits and put it back in stablecoin, and then you wait for the next opportunity.
Yeah.
So that is the, you know, basically the, I would say, the safe haven parking lot from crypto volatility to stable money.
Yes, because you know, when you think that a standard saving account in a bank returns a maximum 1%, a US dollar account or British pounds or euro, and then you know, the equivalent peg from the crypto market returns 10%. You know, this is really interesting to me. If you have the stable coin and you get 10%, I wonder, how can you get so much interest on something that is just staying there, is unproductive? I suppose because people that hold the stable coin then lend it out for trading purposes, is that right?
Exactly.
So is it completely safe, you think? I mean, if the company goes bust, let's say there is some organization that you know, uses a stable coin to fuel some trading operations, and the trading doesn't go very well, or there's a big crash happening, mm-hmm. this company could go bust, is that right, potentially?
Yes, yes.
So that's the risk. That's why it's 10%.
Yeah, to your point saying, well, it's always backed up by the US dollar, and a dollar is a dollar, but if you look at how much the governments have been printing in the last 2 years, it's amazing, because your dollar is only worth, you know, 96 cents at the moment, yeah, in the last 2 years. Mm-hmm. So the inflation is just skyrocketing. Crypto is not safe, but if you look at the US dollar Tether stablecoin, mm-hmm. they have, you know, survived a few audits because It's very important for people to know that that is kind of a stable coin. Mm-hmm. And basically it means for every digital coin, there should be a dollar in a bank account somewhere. And they've survived a couple of audits. Mm-hmm. Crypto is not safe, but it is becoming much safer because governments also realize that they need to, get into that new digital world. Mm-hmm. And they want to regulate it. That's the whole idea, because they want a piece of the pie and they want taxes out of it. And that is both good and bad. Bad in the sense that you will need to start paying taxes on it, yeah, if you start exchanging it and making money with it. Good in the sense that if they start regulating it, they mean it is good and stable and new, and that they're accepting this as currencies now.
Yeah,
and that's what you see with cryptocurrencies, that there's no government in the world, no institution that basically can control what's happening because of where it started from with Bitcoin. And I think it is absolutely interesting, you know, how fast this is growing.
Because I think somebody explained to me there are two aspects of it. One is the technology itself, the blockchain, which can be used for not just currencies, but many other things. And it's a very kind of advanced technology with lots of potential. And then you have the currencies themselves, right? And these two aspects coming together, and that's Bitcoin and Ethereum, etc.
Yeah, what is happening now with NFTs is the hype of the moment. Yeah, like an NFT is basically a non-fungible token, which means there's only one. And if you think about US dollar Tether, there's a billion of them. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so they're all the same. But an NFT is just one. And if you see the creativity of companies on what to do with it, it is just so super interesting to see how much money and how much energy goes into new things like online gaming now for money, where you can play digital games and you have an NFT, meaning a sword in a game, or an asset from your little player. And now they're talking about the metaverse, where you can use all these gadgets or your character online in different kind of games. And it's becoming endless, and it is super interesting to see the development, because it's going so fast that nobody can track it all anymore.
Interesting, okay. So tell me a little bit more about Buddha Cafe. What is your vision for the place?
So Buddha Cafe, I found actually a year and a half ago, and I was going to live there first, but then people showed up because it says Buddha Cafe in the window. And people stepped into my living room every day and say, hey, can I get coffee? So then I go like, I guess I have to open back up Buddha Cafe, which I did. But it is a unique little setting with a little stage and a living room. And basically all the furniture in there is, furniture I brought over from Europe. So it's basically my living room as well. Mm-hmm. So then we started developing things like a living library. Mm-hmm. To have people come and talk and share and promote their own services on the island and products. And then we had some stand-up comedy and you were there.
Yes.
And we had, different dance events, fashion events. So it is a very small space, but you can utilize it for anything. So my vision is now I built a new stage out of a Thai long-tail boat.
And I haven't seen it there.
And now on Friday nights I run Crypto Night. Mm-hmm. And Crypto Night is basically becoming an entertainment program where I also educate people on what's going on in the crypto space, mm-hmm. but also can do like a stand-up comedy act or open mic, some music around it where people can drink in a cocktail, and mostly geared towards the tourists that will come back.
Let's hope.
Yeah. It might still take a while, mm-hmm. but they will come back eventually. But to create something on the Friday night that is, then known as, Friday night, you do Crypto Night, you can get, some information, you have a nice cocktail, a martini, and that's becoming a spot. And besides that, I would like to continue my free education in crypto to get people started, on their way to crypto. So I've done a lot of Thursday morning free education, and in the meantime, together with my friend Filippo, we developed a lot of online content, mm-hmm. for people on certain subjects. Like they can take a one-day course for crypto. So we teach them everything from exchanges to tokens to how do you get in, how do you get out, if you want to get out. So I'm developing different programs in Buddha Cafe, and Buddha Cafe is supposed to be like the community point where you can go to get help, advise, or meet with people and socialize and talk crypto, or just have a cup of coffee and breakfast.
I think it's a lovely idea, you know, to have a space with the different functions to attract people to come on different nights with different events, different themes. I think it's very exciting indeed, you know. And having your own space is kind of fun, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It makes it a lot easier, yeah, because I still live there too. So I set up, like, for instance, one of my old tables as a co-working space where people can just come and use the computer for free. And we have trading classes there before, and we, you know, people can just sit there and work or not. And yeah, I enjoy it a lot to see people coming and going.
And of course, being a cafe, I can still have a cappuccino if I want to.
Absolutely.
Very nice. Well, Edwin, thank you very much. It's been very fun having this chat with you. And I know that the Bitcoin price is pretty high at the moment. So, you know, let's...
It's amazing. Yeah. The expectations are really high over the next 2 months. So let's see what happens.
Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you very much for having me, Luca.